So having a vaccine that's been approved and is safe and can be used across the population is the first step in getting us back to normal. We know that we're going to need lots of different vaccines, and we know that some vaccines will suit particular types of people more than others. So it's the first step, but yes, it is a really important positive step in getting us back to normal.
Like all medicines, even those you buy over the counter like paracetamol, vaccines are not without risk. All of the vaccines that will be used in the UK have undergone rigorous safety checks before they're used in the general population. And we have the same high standards for COVID-19 vaccines as we do for all other vaccines and medicines that we use in the NHS in the UK. We haven't cut any corners in the testing of COVID-19 vaccines. The new vaccines are tested in a number of stages to make sure that they are both safe and effective. They're only used once the independent regulator is completely satisfied.
So I think it's important to understand that people's reaction when they see a vaccine that has appeared so quickly, it's reasonable to ask, well, how have we managed to get so far so quickly? And I think the first thing to say is that we're in an unprecedented situation. The need to develop a vaccine to get us all out of this COVID situation is huge and more pressing than any other kind of illness that we've looked at trying to make vaccines for in the past. And that means that every single scientist that's got a background in making vaccines has been focused on this. And there's a huge amount of resource and time that's gone into developing that. So that's sped the process up very significantly. And then in terms of the clinical trials, because in a typical development of a vaccine, there's not such a huge pressure to get an answer quickly. So what they would typically do is do one section of the clinical trial and then wait and then perhaps start the next section the following year. One of the things that we're doing at the moment to get an answer as quickly as possible is to overlap the trials. So as you're getting the early phase answers for the first part of your clinical trial, you will then design and set up the second part of your clinical trial. And that means that you're able to cover the sort of time much more quickly and get answers quicker. But in terms of the scientific rigor and the safety protocols, they haven't changed at all. And in terms of the number of people that we need in clinical trials, that hasn't changed either. So we're still getting 50,000 people into the later phases so that we can be really sure that the clinical vaccine that we're using is both efficient and safe. That's a really good question, and one that we're still finding the answer out. The clinical trials that are going on at the moment are still in the fairly early phases, so 6 months in, and for the newer vaccines that have come into clinical trials, only just a couple of months in. So at the moment, we're still working out how long the immunity lasts. The flu vaccine, as an example, we know will only last a year, so you have to have a booster every year. But other vaccines will last for 10 years, for example, tetanus vaccine. So we need to look at each individual vaccine and follow people up in the clinical trial to see how long that immunity lasts. So no vaccines are compulsory in the NHS, and the COVID vaccine is going to be no different. Everyone will be offered a choice as to whether they want the vaccine or not. The majority of people will choose to have the vaccine because they're a high-risk group and they want to protect themselves against the disease, which we know has devastating effects both in the short term and long term. But for others, they will choose to have the vaccine to protect the people they care about and to protect our community. My mother-in-law is having chemotherapy at the moment, and I know I would choose to have a vaccine to protect her. So there are lots of different vaccines that we're hearing about in the news, and they will be approved as the safety data comes out from the clinical trial. It's important to remember that we don't usually have one vaccine for an illness. We often have several different types of vaccine, and the NHS will use what they think is the most appropriate for you. So if you get offered a vaccine through your GP, there will have been a considerable amount of thought about which is the best vaccine for you. And so it doesn't actually matter which one you're offered. All of them that have been approved or will be approved will have been shown to be efficient and effective for people with your condition. So each of the different vaccines that we're hearing about in the news have been tested on slightly different groups of people. To be entered into a clinical trial, we generally want people's medical health to be stable, but you can have pre-existing medical conditions such as diabetes. And so a lot of the clinical trials will have groups of patients in them that have chronic medical conditions. We also have recruited participants from the elderly, so up to the age of 84. And so that gives us some information. And a lot of the clinical trials are being run outside of the UK, and in other areas they have recruited from other groups where there are other types of diseases. So there's a broad sort of spectrum, and we will get some information from that. The early data that we've got from the vaccine studies has been very positive. There have been no serious adverse events noted, and the elderly do seem to respond. But we've only got very early data, so we need to wait and see. So part of the purpose of the clinical trials that are active at the moment for the vaccine studies is to identify if there are any adverse events with particular medication. We know that some people who are on blood thinners are more likely to have a bit of bruising after they have an injection for a vaccine, but that doesn't stop people having them. And the flu vaccine, for example, can be taken with lots of other medication. In the early clinical trials, there were no adverse events noted with people on medication. And the purpose of the really big studies that are going on now is to look at thousands of people, so 50,000 people, and to pick up any rarer complications.
We're still going to need a lot of people to volunteer to come forward to take part in our COVID-19 vaccine research. Particularly, we need to engage with people from our Black, Asian and minority ethnic communities, because we know as a community, they are more severely affected by the impact of COVID. And anybody who would like to volunteer to take part in this research needs to visit www.bepartofresearch.nihr.ac.uk. And if you click on that website, you'll be able to register your interest and sign up to the National Vaccine Registry and be considered for participation in a future clinical trial. So the first thing that will happen is you'll need to give your informed consent to your doctor. And that's the conversation that you have, just to make sure that you're happy to take part, that you're eligible to take part, and where the doctor will outline what will happen to you. And I can talk to this from first-hand experience because I volunteered to take part in one of our trials locally recently. Depending on which trial it is that you're in, you will need to go back to the clinic to see the doctor, to give blood, to have your booster injections, and to be monitored and followed up to make sure that you are well and safe. We need to remember that in all of these studies, there is a 50% chance that you might not actually be getting the active vaccine. You might be randomized to the placebo arm, so you won't get the actual vaccine that's being tested. But you undergo exactly the same follow-up and procedures regardless of whether you're in the placebo arm or the active arm.